tonight as we get together and we observe and we honor Monday's service. Monday, another name for this service is Tiambre in Shadows. It's a service of shadows. And this is the first year in 20 years that we have not had a Monday service full of people. It's different, but we are definitely glad that you've logged in and you're seeing the live stream of this evening. And as we look at the Lord's Supper tonight, we're going to hear that message of the Lord's Supper in the Song of the Wise Men.
Thank you.
were children, many of us loved doing something that was called Connect the Dots. And it was a cool way to spend an hour on Sunday morning at Odin First Baptist Church growing up. I'm set with Bill and Nella Smith, and she would always have some type of hard candy and some type of a Connect the Dot type of thing for me to play around with. And when you look at a Connect the Dot page, it's hard to see what the picture is until you start connecting them, until they start coming together, and eventually the full picture comes into view once all the dots were connected. Growing in our faith is not dissimilar in connecting the dots. Growing in our faith and deepening our understanding of our faith is a process of discovery. It is a journey. And in a real way, it's connecting the dots. When you look at things like baptism, the sign of the cross, anointing with oil, laying hands on people, the Lord's Supper is really no different because it is a picture, but for lots of people, unless you know what this connects to, it may not mean a whole lot to you. So all of those things are rich symbols, whether it's baptism or the anointing of the oil or laying on hands. They're all rich with symbolism, and there's beautiful stories and teachings behind them. And when you take the bread and the cup, for example, on their own, they're a floating lot. If it's just bread by itself, it's just bread. If it's just juice by itself, it's just juice. On their own, they're just like a floating dot. There they are. You take the bread and the wine, they are bread and wine, but when you connect them to something else, when you connect them to what we're going to connect them to tonight, they take on a brand new meaning. Jesus connected these dots for us on the night that he was betrayed. He connected the Passover meal to his death. You see, the Passover pointed back to God's deliverance of his people, Israel, from out of the clutches of Pharaoh and the Egyptians. And what happened at Passover, which by the way started last night, Passover, they would take the blood of a lamb, they sacrificed a lamb, took the blood from the lamb, put it over the lintels, the door frame, the facings of their door, and the blood was applied to their homes. And when we look at the Lord's Supper connected to the Passover meal, well, the Lord's Supper points us to the cross of Christ, points us to the suffering of Christ, the death of Christ, the crucifixion and his sacrifice. The spilt blood of an innocent lamb was applied to the door facings in Egypt for the believing Jew and for the believing Egyptian, and allowing us to discover God's deliverance of his people from death once more when we look at the cross. God delivering his people not just once more, but thank God once and for all. So let's connect some dots tonight, shall we? 1 Corinthians chapter 11, verse 23 through 26. The Lord Jesus, in the night in which he took bread, he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And in the same way, he took the cup also after supper, saying, "This cup is a new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and you drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes." So, we've got two dots. We have the wine and we have the bread. Let's connect them to the big picture. Let's connect the dots. The matzo bread, the type that's used in Passover, is a bread that is made without any yeast. Now, in Scripture, yeast is a picture of, in Scripture it's called leaven. Yeast is a picture of sin, defilement, what corrupts us, adding something to who we are. The opposite of leaven would be unleavened bread. No yeast was put into it. There was no rising agent that was introduced to it. Without the yeast, it is a symbol of holiness. It is a symbol of the holiness of God. So this particular type of bread is used during Passover, and we typically use that type of bread during the Lord's Supper. Now tonight, if you've got your own bread, and it's Wonder Bread, don't sweat it. Use it. Maybe you've got Bunny Bread. Don't sweat it. Use it. Maybe you're poor folks like us. You've got Great Value Bread. Don't sweat it. Use it. It's okay because it's a symbol. So if you have a cracker tonight, that's fine. Don't worry about that. It's the picture, it's the meaning that's the most important thing for you to understand this evening. In Passover, there were three pieces of matzah that came together. And the middle piece is what we're going to draw our attention to tonight. About three-fourths of the way of the meal through of Passover, the leader of the house will take out the middle matzah bread, and he will then break it, putting the smaller piece on the table, putting the larger piece in a bag. Now what would happen would be one of two things. Number one, the leader of the house, typically the patriarch of the house, he will take this piece of matzah bread and he will go hide it somewhere for the kids to find it sometime later that evening. Or other times, the person who's leading it, a child will come forward and liberate the bread, or take the bread and steal the bread, if you will. It's not real stuff. It's just symbolism. And what the child will do is he'll hold that bread for ransom. And typically what that ransom is, it's a gift or money or chocolate or something like that. So the leader will pay for that ransom piece of bread back. It's a big time. It's a sweet time. And it's a neat thing. This broken matzah is called the afikomen. The afikomen. And it's a part of every Passover meal. Afikomen is a word that means dessert, but when we think of dessert, we think of something sweet. Afikomen in the Hebrew means something that's last. This is the last thing. This is the last thing that will happen at the Passover. That piece of lost bread will be brought back to the table. That's the last thing that happens at the Passover meal. And the meal was finished. Matzahs are very unified if you look at them. Every one of them look the same, but I can tell you this, there's not one of them that's identical. They're all different. The matzahs are unified, yet they're distinct. They're all different. When we see the three pieces of matzah bread, we're actually seeing an image. We're seeing a symbol, a picture of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Now, don't let the symbolism be lost on you. When we talk about the Father, Son, Holy Spirit, the second person of the Trinity, the second office of the Trinity is the Son. The Son was taken, removed from the side of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. The Son was broken. The Son suffered. The Son was wrapped in cloth and hidden away in a tomb to be found 3 days later. That middle piece of matzah bread, Jesus is connecting the dot from the Lord's Supper back to the Passover. But both of them tell the story of the people's deliverance through the hand and the grace and mercy of God. 1 Corinthians 6:20 says, "For you have been bought with a price. Therefore glorify God with your body." There was a tremendous price for us to be. There was a tremendous price that Jesus paid for us. Remember, the leader would give somebody a ransom or reward for finding the broken piece of bread. Y'all, whenever we find Jesus, there is a tremendous blessing and reward that we receive. When we find Jesus, there is a beautiful ransom that we acknowledge that has been paid for us to be redeemed, restored, and brought back into the family of God. That wonderfully high cost that was paid was none other than the cost of Jesus' own life. So as I look at the bread, and as you get your bread ready at home, I break it off and I share it with you virtually. The Bible says the Lord Jesus, in the night in which he was betrayed, he took the bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." So we connect the bread dot. Let's keep going. Let's connect the cup, the wine, the fruit of the vine. And I've heard some of you feel very uncomfortable when I use the word wine, but allow me to tell you that I'm simply using the biblical vernacular. If you ask me if they served wine or Welch's in the Bible, I'm definitely going to have to go with the former. Our tradition as Baptist is to stick to non-fermented grape juice. And I guess that's about all I have to say about that. Wine, the other symbol Jesus highlights at the supper, in the upper room at the Lord's Supper, the wine that Jesus symbolizes in the Passover, is poured out four different times in the Passover meal. There are four cups that are filled. Most people believe that the cup Jesus filled up was the third cup. Every one of those cups have their own name. The third cup is called the cup of redemption. The cup of redemption, and that was the cup that Jesus poured out when he said, "My blood of the covenant, which is poured out for many for the forgiveness of sin." The cup of redemption traditionally signifies the slaying of the Passover lamb, the blood that was shed by this sacrifice, perfect, blemishless, innocent lamb. That blood would have been then taken, put onto the lintels, the door facing of the house. And when the death angel came over the homes that night, every time the death angel saw blood on the door, that angel passed over and the firstborn did not die. It was only when the death angel saw the blood were the occupants in the home saved. It's poignant when Jesus tells his disciples that the wine in this cup, the cup of redemption, he says, "This is my blood. This is my blood of the covenant, which is poured out for many for the remission of sin." And as the blood of the Passover lamb covered the believing Israelites and Egyptians' door facing in Egypt, so the blood of Jesus covers the heart of every believer today. So when we take the cup, we remember the price that was paid for our redemption, the price that was paid for our ransom. It was paid out in drops of blood. The Bible says, "This cup is a new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." One of the seven last sayings of Jesus on the cross happened nearly at the end of the crucifixion. Reminds me of the afikum meaning, the last thing in the Passover meal. Because one of the last things Jesus said on Calvary is, he said, "It is finished." This is the last thing. The Lamb of God who came to take away the sin of the world, the Lamb of God who came to pay the ransom for humanity, was paid. And all who find the risen Lord are rewarded with eternal life. You see, that reward of eternal life comes to us not because of our merit, but because of God's mercy. That eternal life doesn't come because we've earned it, but because we've been shown grace. The Bible says this, "For as often as you eat this bread and you drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes again." Every year, Miss Pam and I have an anniversary. The reason people get in trouble for forgetting such a thing is because anniversaries are important. They're significant. They mean something. An anniversary is a reminder. Our anniversary reminds her and me of our vows that we proclaimed on December 14th, 1991. Our anniversary reminds us of the commitments we proclaimed on December 14th of 1991. Our anniversary reminds us of where we've been as a couple, where we are today as a couple, where we're going in the future as a couple. And it's a time that we celebrate our shared love and we celebrate our relationship. When we come to the Lord's table and we take the cup and we take the bread and we proclaim, something significant happens. When we eat the bread and we drink the cup, we are reminded of our relationship to Christ. We are reminded of our commitment to Him. Also, it gives us an opportunity to remember what the Father expects of His children. Think of the leader breaking the matzah bread, giving it to His children, wanting them to go look for it, wanting them to go find it. It also is an occasion for us to renew our commitment to be obedient to God, to God's Word, and to God's will. This Lord's Supper is also a time of communion. You see, we are not only connected with the Lord, by the Lord who saved us, but we are also connected to believers in the past. We are also connected to believers who have went on to receive their reward. You see, at the Lord's table, we find comfort. At the Lord's table, we find support. Just as the disciples and the early church did when they came together and broke bread. All Christians who have fallen asleep in Jesus and those who still remain are connected together by those two simple statements. The bread and the cup. Back in 1937, when this church was established, they did the same thing that you and I did tonight. If we would take a bigger chunk and rewind back to 2,000 years, when Jesus was in the upper room with his disciples, they took the bread and we took the cup. You see, these dots connect us together. They connect us together as a family. Family of God. They connect us together as a church. All of us Christians, past, present, and future, we find a common ground at the Lord's table. Well, we've come to the end of our service. At 6:30 tomorrow night, we will be uploading a very special service for Good Friday. Good Friday in the age of COVID-19, so we do encourage you to come and be a part of that program that will be premiered tomorrow night at 6:30. Almighty God, tonight, as we just tell you how much we are thankful for the bread and the cup, Lord, thank you for connecting the dots. Thank you for connecting the dots from Calvary to now, and from Calvary back to the Passover. Lord, we love you, and we adore you. And in Christ's name I pray. And amen.